Okay, so hello everybody, and we're going to continue our journey today from we started the Last Supper, we were at Gethsemane last time, and now we're going to start with the first of Jesus' trials. So let's get going. Okay, last time we talked about Jesus' arrest, the slight differences between especially John and the other Gospels, what Judas did, who arrested him, and now let's see what happens. Mark 14 tells us, and they led Jesus away to the high priest, and with him were assembled all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes. Now, just a side comment, scribes in those days were because not everybody knew how to write. So they would be the people who would write, they'd be the people who would copy Bibles, and they'd also be the people who would take notes. Elders are usually, again, the term rabbi per se exists in Judaism only after the destruction of the temple, where it's used as a title which replaces elders. And also in those days, many of the teachers were priests based on the tradition or Levites. Luke tells us a slightly different story. They took him and led him and brought him to the high priest's house. That's all Luke says. Matthew, quite similar to Mark, tells us, and they that had laid hold on Jesus led him to Caiaphas, the high priest. Again, we'll talk about why is he mentioned here and not elsewhere, where the scribes and elders were assembled. John tells us a whole different story once again, and led him away to Annas, or in the Hebrew name was Hanan first, for he was father-in-law of Caiaphas, which was the high priest that same year. We'll also deal with that very soon. There's no what that same year was, just a side comment. Annas or Hanan had previously been the high priest. And John continues, now Caiaphas was he who gave counsel to the Jews that it was expedient that one man should die for the people. We talked about that in a previous lecture with when he said that following Lazarus's resurrection. Now, what is interesting is the arrest of Peter, John, and other apostles in Acts 4, and we're told, as they spake unto the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. In other words, they weren't happy with the teaching that was going on in the temple, and they laid hands on them and put them in hold until the next day. Very important, remember that point of to the next day, for it was now evented. And Annas the high priest, now this is a big problem. How did Annas suddenly become the high priest? It was just Caiaphas, same period, and Caiaphas, and John, and Alexander, and as many were of the kindred of the high priest who gathered together in Jerusalem. We're told about five brothers that were there. Chapter 5, once again, the arrest taking place. Then the high priest rose up, and all that were with him, which is a sect of Sadducees. And again, in the book of Acts, it's very important to emphasize that, and were filled with indignation and laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. In other words, the two cases that we're told about people being arrested in Acts, they were arrested and kept in a cell on the Temple Mount. They were arrested in the temple and they were kept in a cell there. Unlike Jesus, that we're told was either brought to Hanan, Annas' house, or to Caiaphas's house. Now, who was Caiaphas? Let's see what we know about him. Josephus tells us this, upon whose death Tiberius Nero, his wife Julia's son, succeeded, which it's 15 AD. He was now the third emperor and sent Valerius Gratus to be the protector of Judah and to succeed Annius Rufus. It doesn't really matter their names. This man deprived Annaeus of the high priesthood. In other words, he took, Annaeus, that is actually the same, Annas just spelled differently, that's the Hanan, and appointed Ismail, the son of Fabi, to be the high priest. He also deprived him in a little time and ordained Eliezer, the son of Hanan, who was the high priest before, to be high priest, which office, when he had held for a year, Gratus deprived him of it and gave the high priesthood to Simon, the son of Camithus. And when he had possessed that dignity no longer than a year, Joseph Caiaphas. Now now in reality, his name was Joseph, the son of Caiaphas, but he was known as Caiaphas. In other words, he was known based on his father's name. His actual name was Joseph, who was made successor. So you can see that the element of priesthood was a political position. It was officially a religious position, but it was a position that had major political clout. And the leaders could pass it over. When Gratus had done these things, he went back to Rome after he had tarried in Judah 11 years, when Pontius Pilate came as his successor. Now, Pontius Pilate, as we'll talk about in our next talk, was somebody, and always, that position was somebody who rose from within the cavalry of the Roman army. So they weren't the elite of society, but it was an ideal way to gain an awful lot of power. And then we're told, but Vitellius put those garments in our own power, as in days of our forefathers, and ordered the captain of the guard not to trouble himself to inquire where they were laid or when they were used. And this he did as an act of kindness to oblige the nation to him. Besides which, he also deprived Joseph, who was called Caiaphas of the high priesthood, and appointed Jonathan, the son of Annas, the former high priest, to succeed him, after which he took a journey back to Antioch. Now, so here we have the commander of the whole region, not just of Judea, who removed Caiaphas from his position in the year 36. And surprise, surprise, a short time after that, but when the tumult was appeased, there was a Samaritan uprising. They appealed to the courts, and the Samaritan Senate sent in an embassy to Vitellius, a man that had been consul and who is now president of Syria, and accused Pilate of the murder of those that were killed, because Pilate was a ruthless person. We'll talk about more or less and see how that works in with the trial of Jesus. For that, they did not go to Tirabetha in order to revolt from the Romans, but to escape the violence of Pilate, et cetera, et cetera. And at the end, we're told it's over here. So Pilate, when he had tarried 10 years in Judea from 26 to 36, made a haste to Rome, and this in obedience to the orders of Vitellius, which he durst not contradict. But before he could get to Rome, Tiberius was dead. And a short time later, we're not sure if Pilate committed suicide or he was killed. So that's Pilate. Now here we have a fantastic find that was found in the Talpiot neighborhood in Jerusalem. That's in the southern part of Jerusalem. This is an amazing asuarius, a burial box, which the bones of somebody who was buried would be put. They found a family tomb. This was by far the most beautiful of them. You can see the fantastic rock work. And suddenly we see here, and this spells out Yosef ben Kaifa, or Kofa, really. In other words, this is most likely the actual box that Caiaphas was buried in. It is on display in the Israel Museum. And so we actually find a direct link to him, most likely. Now, here we have Yosef bar Caiapha. Yosef bar Caiapha, bar in Aramaic means the son of, like a bar mitzvah is the son of the commandments. And let's see what we're told a little bit about him. Rabbi Meir, but the sages, Samiriam, daughter of Yeshua, son of Caiapha. So we're told about a woman, his daughter, Miriam, the son of Caiapha, priest of Mazel from Beit Imri, seven from the time of Ezra, and who prepared them, Simon the Just and Yohanan the high priest prepared too. And here we're told about each one of the people. We have, remember, there's a mix in of two sources here, but what's important is here we see a line that says, Elohenai, the son of Hakoth. This, we're talking about, there's a discussion in the Mishnah, which is the oral law from the third century, on who sacrificed red heifers. And here we see that Elihonai, the son of Hakoth, which really is Kayafa. Now, why is this important? Because Hakoth in Hebrew means the monkey. In other words, we see from here that the people who wrote the Mishnah, we're talking about Pharisees, despised Kayafa. So he wasn't an especially liked person, especially because if he survived for that long a period, that means he was buddy-buddy with the Romans, which usually was not taken well. With regard to the prominent priests and those like them, Abba Shaul ben Bantit said in the name of Abba Yosef ben Hanin, woe is me due to the high priests. And here are a number of high priesthoods, families, because there were 24 families of priests. And here we're again, we're talking about a rabbinical, so a Pharisee oriented, and saying how terrible these families are. Woe is me, the high priests of the house of Betus. Woe is me due to their clubs. In other words, they were very violent people. Woe is me due to the high priests of the house of Hanin. Woe is me due to their whispers and rumors they spread. Woe is me to the high priests of the house of Katros. Woe is me due to their pens and that they write lies. So here we see three families that most of the high priests came from and were warned about them. Why is this important? Till today, and many people till today will say that Kayafa came from the house of Katros. But we'll see, there might be. And here we see a weight that was found in what's called the burnt house in Jerusalem. And on it, it says Katros. So it was a weight that the priest would have used to weigh offerings that would probably be brought to them when they were in the temple. So here, an actual house that we know belonged to the family of Katros, maybe to the high priest himself. Here, once again, the Suarius of that was found closer to the plain area near where the battle of David and Goliath took place. And if you look very closely up top here, we can see some writing. And the writing says to us, Miriam, daughter of Yeshua, son of Kayafa, priest of Maaziah from Beit Imri. So this might be the actual burial of, there's the box used to put the bones of Kayafa's daughter-in-law or daughter. And in this case, they say from the family of Maaziah, which might means he might not have been from the house of Katrus. So where is Kayafas mentioned? This is very important because if you ask anybody the story of the arrest of Jesus, who was the high priest who tried him, of course it's Kayafas. In reality, he's only mentioned 7 times. Matthew 26, as we read before, they assembled together, the chief priests, and the high priest who was called Kayafas. And then in the next verse once again, and they that had laid hold on Jesus led him away to Kayafas the high priest. Luke mentions Kayafas, Anas, Hanan, and Kayafas being high priests. And this repeats itself a number of times. And we have to question ourselves exactly what the status was. Even though Josephus tells us of Kayafas being the high priest for 18 years, too many times they're interchanged. And it's a big question we don't know, because Luke was quite accurate in what he was writing. The word of God came unto John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness. John 11, and one of them named Kayafas being the high priest that same year, which is also very strange. What do you mean that year? We know that the high priests exchanged, but according to Josephus, he was around for a long time. So Why does John make a point of mentioning that year? Because he does it again when what we just read before, and led him to Ananias first, and that who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas. And he continues, and now Caiaphas, which gave counsel to the Jews. And then later on in the chapter, once again, John mentions that they led Jesus from Caiaphas over to Pilate. So here we see the mentionings of Caiaphas. As you can see, one, Mark is missing, and two, we know very little. Then once again, in Acts 4, and Annas the high priest, and Caiaphas and John Alexander, as we read before. And we're not talking a huge distance there. We're talking this almost the same period. So what is going on here? We have high priests, and suddenly we have Hanan. We don't have a good answer for it, but what is very possible is the tradition that was passed down from generation to generation said that it was Caiaphas who was the one that Jesus was brought to, and that's why that emphasis has to be said over again. Well, here are a few questions that we're going to try to answer very soon. Where was Jesus taken? Who were there? Was he tried, and for what? What was he accused of doing? Does the story actually make sense? So let's start. We'll continue with the story from the various sources. We start with Mark, of course. You know, it's not the first book, but historically, he is said to be the earliest. And Matthew and Luke partially use him as one of their two sources. And they led Jesus away to the high priest, no mentioning of a name. And with him were assembled the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes. Matthew, and that they laid hold on Jesus, led him away to Caiaphas, the high priest. And again, where the scribes and elders were assembled. Remember that? Then they took him and led him and brought him into the high priest's house. And Peter followed afar off. And last but not least, and they led him to Hanan first, and for he was the father-in-law. No mentioning of that is only later did he make it to Caiaphas' house. Now, so we have them being led away. Let's see where this might be. This is the church of St. Peter in Gallicanto, or St. Peter in the crow of the cock. Now, why is this important? We're not going to deal with it today, but the element of Peter denying Jesus three times. So is this the home of Caiaphas? This is traditionally where most people will come to see it. And then in the basement, we have this very nicely carved area with a big hole in the top, which is traditionally where the prison was. The only problem with it, well, there are many problems. One is this hole, of course, was used for a cistern, and this was used as a cistern. It was used as a cistern in the time of Jesus or later, we don't know. The location is very problematic because it's on the side of the mount of Mount Zion, not where the wealthiest of the Jews would have lived. Here we see a different site, which is commemorated by the Armenians. See the beautiful Armenian tiles, and it's in a church dedicated to the purpose that unfortunately has never been finished, and the Armenians ran out of money, and of course today they're even worse off. And just side comment, we are commemorating the Armenian genocide today. So here we see the Armenian, here we see crosses, Armenian crosses that have been carved in, because each person that would come, again, we now know from research just published in the last year, that it wasn't each person would carve a cross, but they would have somebody there who would carve the cross for them to commemorate their reaching the place. So here we have a second option. But unlike, let's say, Mount Zion, we don't have that long lasting tradition. And maybe it was over in this beautiful mosaic found. It was called the Herodian Quarter, which was the wealthiest quarter of the old city where as a whole priests would live. And once again, you see these beautiful jugs. This is what are the story in Cana of the water turning into wine. This would be used for water or for more than for wine. And then this could be turned into wine in the right conditions. Here we can see a beautiful personal ritual bath along a mosaic floor. Again, the priests would want to purify themselves on a regular basis when they were, especially when they were working in the temple. They found houses with multiple mikvahs, a ritual bath. So maybe here, or maybe even here. This is the house of Katros that we talked about, that maybe the original theory was that Caiaphas was from the house of Katros. And this is a house where that weight with the mentioning of Katros was made. This house, as was this, was all were all discovered when following the Six-Day War, when Israel entered the Old City and the Jewish quarter had been more or less destroyed, and to when they were starting to build infrastructure to rebuild the quarter, there was an ability to dig it up and some amazing finds were found. Here we see an attempt to depict the destruction of the temple. And why? Because we're continuing with our story. And the chief priests and all the council sought for witnesses against Jesus to put him to death and found none. So remember all the council and to put him to death. For many bear false witness against him, but their witness agreed not together. In other words, in the Jewish tradition, we'll talk about that a bit in a minute, we have to interrogate the witnesses, and if they don't have identical testimony, their testimony is useless. And there arose certain and bear false witness against him, saying, we heard him say, I will destroy the temple that is made with hands, and within 3 days, I will build another made without hands. Very important to remember that also, but neither so did their witnesses agree together. In other words, they weren't able to have identical witnesses. And the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, saying, answerest thou nothing? What is it with these witnesses against thee? Why aren't you saying anything? And that's a very important question from a Jewish legal purpose, and we'll deal with that. Matthew tells a similar story. Now, the chiefs, the elders, and all the council. Just like Mark, what is all the council? We'll deal with that in just a couple of seconds. Sought false witnesses against Jesus to put him to death, but found none. Yea, their many false witnesses came, yet found they none. And the last came two false witnesses and said, this fellow said, I am able to destroy the temple of God. Again, slight difference. Here we're saying the temple of God, and build it in 3 days. And the high priest arose and said to him, answerest thou nothing? What is with these witnesses against thee? So we see that Mark and Matthew clearly are using the same source. Luke tells a slightly different story. And he starts telling about the people, and the men that held Jesus mocked him and smote him. And when they had blindfolded him, they struck him in the face and asked him, saying, prophesy, who is it that smote thee? In other words, they were poking fun at him and challenging his ability to prophesize. Now, prophesize again in Judaism is to speak the word of God. They're taking it a stage farther and saying you have to know things that others can't know. And many other things blasphemously spake they against him. And the element of blasphemy will come to play a part very soon. And as soon as it was day, very, very important, the elders of the people and the chief priests and the scribes came together and led them into their council. John tells us nothing. Now, when did the trial take place? We just heard that Luke said it was in the day. In Mark and Matthew's case, it was right when he was led away. And as Luke said, and as it was day, Mark and Matthew at night. John, there was really no trial or inquiry. There was a discussion, almost a theological discussion. So, who tried Jesus? Mark says, and the chief priests and all the council. What is the council? We'll find out in 1 second. Matthew, now the chiefs and the elders and all the council. Now, that's a big difference, and we'll understand what it means. Luke, the elders of the people and the chief priests and the scribes came together and led him into their council. Also, very important, the council, their council. John, he was still at Annas' house. Now, why were all these points I pointed out important? in the Babylonian Talmud, again, written in the 5th century based on writings that were written in the Mishnah in the 3rd century, were based on the traditions that existed from the time of Jesus. And we're told, in cases of monetary law, the court judges during the daytime and may conclude the deliberations and issue the ruling even at night. In the cases of capital law, the court judges during the daytime and concludes the deliberations and issues the ruling only in the daytime. In other words, and we're talking about the actual court. Now, the court in Jewish tradition, we'll elaborate about it in one second, is called the Sanhedrin. And here you can see there are 71 people seated. There were two types of courts. There was the Great Sanhedrin of 71, which met only in the temple. And then there were also Sanhedrins of 23, which could also issue, in some cases, we'll see when, a death sentence. Now, the Talmud continues. In case of monetary law, the court may conclude the deliberations and issue the ruling even on the same day, whether to exempt the accused or find him liable. In other words, they can have a verdict either which way. In cases of capital law, the court may conclude the deliberations and issue the ruling even on the same day to acquit the accused, but must wait until the following day to find him liable. Therefore, since capital cases may continue 2 days, the court does not judge cases of capital law on certain days, neither on the eve of the Sabbath, nor on the eve of a festival. Now we have a major problem, because if the group that came to try Jesus was the Sanhedrin, even according to John, that said it was the evening of Passover, and for sure, according to the Synoptic Gospels, it said it was the day, the eve, there was already the Feast of the Unleavened Breads, they could not meet, and for sure not pass a verdict on the same day, that we'll see what they passed later. Conclusion, could not meet at night on the eve of the Feast of Unleavened, and for sure not on the holiday itself. Here, just a side comment, is an amazing find that was found 2 or 3 years ago, very close to the Western Wall. This might have been a city council, it might have been an odeon, a small place for music. It could also have been a place for the small Sanhedrin to meet. And it is, you can actually visit it today, and it seats just about the right number for the 23 people. What is traditionally, the council is the Sanhedrin. Where does the term Sanhedrin come from? In Hebrew, Sanhedrin, derived from the Greek synodrion, which means sitting together, in other words, a council or an assembly. In other words, the Aramaic word which is used, Sanhedrin, comes from the Greek, and it's an assembly or a gathering of some type. But you have the official Sanhedrin, which is a set group of people, of rabbis, of priests, of leaders, or it can just be a group of people. The Great Sanhedrin has 71 members, the Small Sanhedrin has 23. Who sits in the Sanhedrin? Priests and Levites must be members of the, part of it has to be made of them, and that's based on the verse in Deuteronomy, and thou shalt come unto the priests and the Levites and unto the judge. So when you're going for judgment, there must be priests and Levites. All of the members of the Sanhedrin also knew all 70 languages, tradition where there were 70 languages, partially repeats itself in the story of Pentecost. As Rabbi Yochanan says, the place of the Great Sanhedrin, only men of wisdom, of pleasant appearance, of high stature, and of suitable age, so they will be respected. That's from the Babylonian Talmud, the tractate Menachot. The Sanhedrin consisted of Kohanim, priests, Levites from the tribe of Levi, as were the Kohanim, but the Kohanim were descendants of Aaron, and Israelites. Here's a very important point. The high priest was not the head of the Sanhedrin. There were periods when the high priest would be known as the Av Beit Din, who was the the number two, there was the president of the Sanhedrin, and there was the like the speaker of the house of the Sanhedrin. But the high priest was not the Sanhedrin. In other words, if Caiaphas was the high priest, he could not have convened the Sanhedrin, even if we didn't have to deal with the other issues we had to deal with before. Now, if we go back to what we talked about when we were talking about who came to arrest him, except for John, we're talking about priests. So it's very possible that everybody who was in that group that decided to interrogate and investigate and maybe sentence Jesus to death were not members of the Sanhedrin, but actually some group of priests. And we'll kind of go a little farther. And corresponding to these 10 stages, talking about the 10 stages of the exile of the Sanhedrin, was exiled in 10 stages at the end of the Second Temple period and after the destruction of the temple, as it is known from tradition. From the chamber of the hewn stone, that's where the Sanhedrin would meet, it fixed seat in the temple. Then to Chanut, which means a shop, which is already outside, and then from Chanut to Jerusalem, and from Jerusalem to Yavne, and it moved away. Now, it moved away, even several generations after the temple was destroyed, they continued to judge cases of fines in the land of Israel. Eretz Yisrael means the land of Israel. In other words, the Sanhedrin continued to function, but rather to amend and say that they no longer judged capital cases. The authority to impose death penalty was stripped from the Sanhedrin, and therefore they likely left the chamber of the hewn stone. Now, it was taken away from them by the Romans. Since the Sanhedrin no longer convenes in the designated place, the Jewish law no longer gives them the right to judge capital cases. Now, this took place around 28, 29 AC, after the common era, CE. In other words, when Jesus was tried by whoever tried him, death penalties were already not permissible. Now, who do we know were members of this council? Just a couple of examples. Now, there was a man named Joseph of Arimathea, a member of the council. In other words, he was a member of the Sanhedrin, a good and upright man. Of course, he was a Pharisee, not a Sadducee. And in Acts 5, we meet another good person who sat there. When they heard this, they were furious and wanted to put them to death. We're talking about the arrest of Jesus' disciples. But a Pharisee named Gamaliel, who later on we're also told that Paul said he was his teacher, a teacher of the law, who was honored by all the people, stood up in the Sanhedrin. In this case, this is the NIV translation because the King James Version got it wrong, stood up in the Sanhedrin, because in Greek, actually here it says the word Sanhedrin, in order that the men be put outside for a little while. Then he addressed the Sanhedrin, men of Israel, consider carefully what you intend to do to these men. In other words, once again, Gamaliel was also a Pharisee, a member of the Sanhedrin. The majority of the people on the Sanhedrin were Pharisees. And even though the priests were predominantly Sadducees who saw Jesus as a huge threat on one level because he was challenging them in the temple, theologically they saw a challenge because they did not believe in the afterlife. So now things are starting to come into place from my highly subjective perspective that the people that tried Jesus, then we'll continue with this trial in just one second, were most likely made up of priests and were not actually the Sanhedrin itself, for sure not the large Sanhedrin because they could not meet, and a smaller Sanhedrin also would not meet, but maybe it was a group of the priests. There is a theory which I think is baseless. We know there was actually a court in the temple made up solely of priests, but they would deal mainly with issues connected to the temple itself and the sacrifices. Now, we were told that they came to bear false witness, as Matthew says, but if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more. Here we have why? that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. Here we're told by Matthew, quoting the Jewish law, that demands two or three witnesses. And in this case, Matthew is almost exactly quoting Deuteronomy, at the mouth of two witnesses or three witnesses, shall he that is worthy of death be put to death. But at the mouth of one witness, he shall not be put to death. In other words, as we were told in Mark and Matthew, that they called witnesses, and they always used the term plural because that was the Jewish law, that there had to be two witnesses. One witness alone wouldn't do it. And Revelations continues as a whole different story. But once again, I will give power unto my two witnesses. Again, the preservation of the Jewish tradition. Now, what do you need to do? What is the court obliged to do when they're interrogating the witnesses? That you must inquire, probe, and investigate it thoroughly. And if it is true, and it has been proved that this detestable thing has been done amongst you. This, again, they're talking about idolatry, but the obligation to investigate the witnesses. And in Jewish law, if you are found to be a false witness, whatever you are testifying against that person, you receive the same punishment they would have received. Now, Jesus was asked, "Answerest thou nothing?" Why did the high priest ask him that? One of the reasons might be because perhaps the accused must bring an offering. This is a discussion in the Talmud, because he remains silent. In other words, you're being tried and you have to bring a sacrifice for remaining silent. Why? As there is a principle that silence is considered like admission. In the Jewish tradition, which we're told, shtika kahavaya. Have, it's really in Aramaic, that being quiet is like confessing. That's why the high priest says, Jesus, what's going on? I want an answer, because if you don't give me an answer, that means you're confessing to these sins. Jesus went on and said this, I will destroy this temple that is, or he was accused of saying, I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and within 3 days, I will build another made without hands. And both Mark and Matthew emphasize that they were false witnesses. Now, there's a problem with that, because John chapter 2, and again, keep in mind the whole story of the turning over of the tables and the everything that happened in the temple is in the Synoptic Gospels. John tells the story much, much earlier in the very beginning of John. He turned over the tables, they turned to him, then answered the Jews and said unto him, what sign, what does a sign mean? We'll see in a minute. Shewest thou unto us, seeing that thou doest these things. They ask for a sign, and Jesus answered and said unto them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Now, there have been many interesting interpretations saying that, well, here we say, I will destroy the temple. He says, you destroy the temple. I will raise it up. He doesn't say with hands, without hands. It's quite accurate. It's almost an identical quotation. And again, keep in mind, in those days, there was no BBC. There was no Sky News. Things were not quoted exactly. But then said the Jews, 40 and 6 years was the temple in building. In other words, when Jesus was talking to them, the temple had been, they were working on building it for 46 years. And the truth of the matter is, everything around it wasn't even completed when it was destroyed. And wilt thou rear it up in 3 days? But he spake of the temple of his body. Now here, John makes a point. Again, it's an interpretation, but it's important for him to say, Jesus did not claim to say he was going to destroy the temple. He was talking about his body, and then he was actually talking about his resurrection. Is that the case? Well, this is very clearly what John said. But again, keep in mind, that's not what Jesus said. That's John's interpretation, which is put into the text, which justifies his saying that. And then disproves the later claims that we came across in Mark and Matthew. At the same time, we come across the Gospel of Thomas, which again was one of the Gospels that didn't make it into the New Testament, but in Gospel of Thomas, chapter 71. All Jesus is quoted as saying, I will destroy this house and none shall be able to build it again. No, my body, not my body. So we have an additional source actually saying that Jesus said that he would destroy the temple. Now, why is it important that they said they want a sign? Because we read, and in the book of Deuteronomy, I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, like unto thee, and will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command. You know, we're talking about a prophet. And so the prophet speaks, and it shall come to pass that whoever's will not hearken unto my words, which he speaks in my name, I will require it from him. But the prophet, which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or that shall speak in the name of other gods, even that prophet shall die. In other words, what is important here? What we're seeing is that the high priests are telling us a story that they're challenging and saying, here, you said you would destroy the temple. In reality, their claim is baseless. Even if Jesus did say this, and even if they consider it a prophecy, there's no time limit on it. So their claim that even if they would have found the witnesses that could actually have identical testimony and say, Jesus said he was going to destroy the temple, or that if you destroy it, I will rebuild it, there's nothing to try him on, because you can't say he's a false prophet, because what he said, there was still plenty of time for it, yes, to come to take place or not take place. So from a Jewish legal perspective, the high priest and the people with him were making baseless claims. Now, in Mark 14, we continue, and we're told, but Jesus held his peace and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said unto him, art thou the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? And Jesus said, I am. And ye shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. Now, very important. What does Jesus say? I am the Christ, the Son of the Blessed. What exactly that means is not clear. And ye shall see the Son of Man sitting. He didn't say, I am the Son of Man. You shall see the Son of Man sitting to the right of power. Then the high priest rent his clothes and saith, what need we further witnesses? Ye have heard blasphemy. What think ye? And they all condemned him to be guilty of death. So for what Jesus said here, they said he should be condemned to death. We'll understand in 1 minute why, again, according to Jewish law, what was said here by the high priest is baseless. And some began to spit on him and cover his face and to buffet him and say unto him, prophesy. And his servants did strike him with the palms of their hands. Matthew tells us a similar story, but Jesus held his peace. And when the high priest asked and said unto him, I adjure thee by the living God, in other words, you have to give it, swear to me, that thou tell us whether thou be the Christ, the Son of God. So here we already have a different term, the Christ, but the Son of God. Jesus saith to them, thou hast said, nevertheless, I say unto you, hereafter shall ye see the Son of Man sitting to the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. So did Jesus say to him that he was the Son of God? No, he did not. He used the term Son of Man, which we'll learn about in 1 second. Then the high priest rent his clothes, saying, he hath spoken blasphemy. What further need have we witnesses? Behold, now ye heard his blasphemy. What think ye? They answered and said, he is guilty of death. Then they did spit in his face and buffed him, and others smote him with the palms of their hands. Similar to the story of Mark that took place, of Luke, but that took place before the trial, saying, prophesy unto us, thou Christ, who is he that smote thee? Luke tells a slightly different story, And as soon as it was day, the elders and the people and the chief priests and the scribes came together and led him into their council, saying, Art thou the Christ? Tell us. And he said unto them, If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I also ask you, you will not answer me, nor let me go. Hereafter shall the Son of Man again sit to the right hand of the power of God. And they said, Art thou the Son of God? And he said unto them, Yes, say, ye say that I am. Because I didn't say it, you said that. That, of course, repeats itself with Pilate later. And they said, What need we further witness? For ourselves have heard it from his own mouth. John tells a whole different story. Now, Caiaphas was he, which gave counsel to the Jews, as we read before. The high priest then asked Jesus and his disciples of his doctrine. Tell me what it's all about. Jesus answered him, I spake openly to the world. I ever taught in the synagogue and in the temple, whither the Jews always resort. And in secret, I have said nothing. Jesus said, I've been totally open with what I'm saying. Why askest thou me? Ask them which heard me, which I have said unto them. Behold, they know what I said. And when he had thus spoken, one of the officers which stood by struck Jesus with the palm of his hand, saying, Answereth thou the high priest so? Jesus answered him, If I have spoken evil, bear witness of the evil. But if well, why smittest thou me? Now Annas has sent him bound unto Caiaphas the high priest. So in John, we have a whole different story. There's no trial. Jesus talks about Son of Man. Son of Man appears many times, or a good number of times in the Bible. In Deuteronomy, we are told, you are children. The word actually is benimatem. You are sons of the Lord your God. In Psalms, King David says, What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visiteth him? He's talking about himself. In Ezekiel, we're getting a little more messianic. And he said unto me, Son of man, stand up upon thy feet, and I will speak unto thee. In other words, calling somebody son of man, there's really nothing that serious about it. In Daniel, it already has major messianic meanings. I saw the night vision. Behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient Days and brought him near before him. In other words, now the Son of Man already has a connection to the heavens, which Jesus talked about afterwards. In the book of Enoch, again, made it into the Ethiopian Bible, and copies of it were found in Egypt and in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Enoch chapter 46 says this, He answereth and saying to me, This is the Son of Man who has righteousness, who with whom dwells righteousness, and who reveals all the treasures of that which is hidden. Because the Lord of the spirits has chosen him, and whose lot has been the preeminence before the Lord of the spirits and the uprightness forever. This Son of Man, whom you have seen, shall raise up the kings and the mighty from their seats and the strong from their thrones, and shall loosen the reins of the strong and break the teeth of the sinners. Here we already have an Enoch, again, a book written 150 years before Jesus, already is talking about what the meaning of the Son of Man that Jesus is talking about, which will scare the high priest, because here we see somebody which has a direct connection to God and has major powers. He used the term Christ. Now, what is Christ? Christ means anointed. In Hebrew, Mashiach, somebody which is where the term Messiah comes from. Who is anointed? In Exodus 28, we read, And thou shalt put upon Aaron thy brother and his sons with him, and shall anoint them. In other words, we're anointing the priests and the high priest. In First Samuel chapter 9, Samuel is told, Tomorrow about this time I will send thee a man out of the land of Benjamin, and thou shalt anoint him to be captain over my people. In other words, to be the king, that he may save my people out of the hands of the Philistines, for I have looked upon my people because their cry is coming unto me. And when Samuel saw Saul, the Lord said unto him, behold the man whom I spake of thee, and the same shall reign over my people. So who are anointed? Priests and kings. Isaiah 61. Isaiah 61 is the chapter that Jesus read when he was reading from the prophets in the synagogue in Nazareth, saying that he has come to fulfill this chapter. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. In other words, just like the priest and the king are chosen by God, so Isaiah is saying this, and Jesus is saying, this refers to me. Jesus was accused of blasphemy. And due to that, the priest said he should be executed. What is blasphemy? Exodus 22, verse 28, thou shalt not revile the gods, nor curse the ruler of thy people. Do not speak evil things against God. Do not curse the ruler of your people. That's blasphemy. That's the definition. In Leviticus, we're told another thing. Anyone who speaks evil things against my name, this is God talking, must be put to death. You speak evil things against God, you are put to death. The whole community must kill them by throwing stones at them. It does not matter whether they are an outsider or an Israelite. When they speak evil things against my name, they must be put to death. In the tractate Sanhedrin, in the Babylonian Talmud, we're told, with regard to the term the Lord, this alludes to the blessing the name. Now, the blessing in rabbinic literature, when you talk about somebody who is blind, you don't say he's blind, you say he's full of light. When you talk about cursing God, you don't want to say cursing God, so you say blessing him, but meaning that actually they're cursing him, because already saying cursing is seen as a bad thing. So this alludes to the blessing the name of God. And so it states in another verse, and he who blasphemies the name of the Lord shall be put to death. Again, quoting Leviticus, slightly different translation between King James and the original. God, this alludes to idol worship. And so it states, you may have no other gods. So blasphemy is also worshiping other gods. And in Exodus 20, the man, this alludes to bloodshed, and so it states, one who sheds blood of a man, may by man his blood shall be shed. So now we know what blasphemy is. Now, there are three verbs that are used in Hebrew to define cursing. One is nukev, mentioning, gadaf, G-D-F, or gadaf, which is saying negative things, and kilel is to curse. Now, none of these three biblical offenses, all translated as blasphemy, correspond to Jesus' answer. So that's why, interestingly enough, the one place where Jesus' trial in the Talmud is mentioned, it makes the Jewish version of Jesus' trial actually says in which there are no Romans, which is a whole interesting story. And Jesus convicted and put to death by the Jewish authorities. He's not accused of blasphemy, he is accused of incitement, because there is no mentioning anywhere of Jesus blasphemy, saying anything. So the priest's claims are baseless. Now, are these claims put in the mouth of the priests by the writers of the New Testament? Or was it actually what happened, and thus they broke from the Jewish tradition? Now, to understand what blasphemy is, I found the perfect source, and that, as usual, they are 100% accurate.
Matthias, son of Deuteronomy of Gath?
Do I say yes?
Yes.
Yes.
You have been found guilty by the elders of the town of uttering the name of our Lord, and so as a blasphemer, you are to be stoned to death. Look, I had a lovely supper, and all I said to my wife was, that piece of halibut was good enough for Jehovah.
Blasphemy!
He said it again. Did you hear him? Are there any women here today? Very well. By virtue of the authority vested in me.
Oh, lay off. We haven't started yet.
Come on. Who threw that? Who threw that stone? Come on. Sorry, I thought
we started.
Go to the back. Oh, dear. Always one, isn't there? Now, where were we?
Look, I don't think it ought to be blasphemy. Just saying Jehovah.
You're only making it worse for yourself.
Making it worse? How could it be worse? Jehovah, Jehovah, Jehovah.
I'm warning you, if you say Jehovah once more. Right, who threw that? Come on, who threw that? Was it you? Yes. Right. Well, you did say Jehovah. Will you stop that? Come in. Now look, no one is to stone anyone until I blow this whistle. Do you understand? Even, and I want to make this absolutely clear, even if they do say Jehovah.
So, lo and behold, Monty Python gets it exactly right. Using God's name in vain is blasphemy. What Jesus did is not defined as blasphemy. And interestingly enough, the actual punishment for blasphemy is stoning, not as it was done there, but that's a whole different story. Here are a few problems that we need to deal with. In the tractate of Sanhedrin, Rabbi Yossi says, a defendant is never executed unless the mouths of his two witnesses are those who warn him as it is stated. At the mouth of two witnesses or at the mouth of three witnesses shall he that is to die be put to death. In other words, the Jewish law totally discredits what the priests did because somebody can't be punished just for doing something wrong. You have to warn them ahead of time. You have to tell them what you're doing is, you see them doing something which is illegal. That person does it again, and the same people that warned them have to be the people that see them doing it again, and then they testify. In no way did Jesus qualify for that. The verse emphasizes on the phrase, at the mouths, teach us that the witness must issue a warning themselves. A person cannot incriminate himself. In other words, even if Jesus stood up and said, I am the Son of God, you can't incriminate yourself. You can't, your testimony is not accepted. And once again, in Sanhedrin, it says exactly that. A person is his own relative. Now, what does that mean? In the Jewish tradition, relatives are forbidden from testifying against their own relatives. And a person is considered a relative of themselves and therefore may not testify about himself. Therefore, a person cannot render himself wicked by his own testimony. You can't say, I did ABC. You can stand up and say, I murdered without two witnesses who actually saw it. You can't be found guilty. Now, taking it a stage farther, blasphemy was something that truly did not interest the Romans. So even if the Jewish court that we know could not try people to be executed, if the high priest would come to the Roman authorities and say, this man spoke blasphemy, he needs to die, they would say, goodbye, nice seeing you. I have more important things to deal with. especially since the Romans were pagans themselves. So the story that we were told of Jesus' trial does not totally come together. Now, there are multiple explanations why this is. Some say that the court that was held was where they were all Sadducees and there were no Pharisees. So they didn't exactly follow the same Pharisee traditions that the Talmud is based on. But even so, the basic elements of what is blasphemy, what is not blasphemy, is not a question of interpretation. So that doesn't exactly work. What exactly was said there? What was Jesus accused of is also not clear, and who sat in the trial. It is, to my opinion, clear beyond doubt it could not have been the actual official Sanhedrin, which was made up predominantly of Pharisees, who wouldn't accuse Jesus of almost anything based on things. They would have religious differences, but that would not be reason to try them. And of course, Jews could not sentence to death or execute in the times of Jesus. So we have Jesus being brought by the high priest and by Sadducees to be tried or to be investigated, or a verdict is reached which opposes Jewish law, but Jews could arrest people and hand them over to the Romans for trial. So with that, we will conclude today's talk, and we will have another talk awaiting in the near future, where we will finally, and it will almost coincide with the Orthodox Easter, which is taking place. This is the Orthodox Good Friday, and Sunday will be the Orthodox Easter, a whole different lecture on why the two churches have such major differences in their dating.